Welcome to the lecture by Rustam Barucha, Rethinking Interculturalism, From Performance to Policy. As I've said, I've been spying on this individual for your convenience, and I've discovered that he's a professor of theater and performance studies at the Faculty of Arts and Aesthetics in, don't laugh at my pronunciation, Jawaharlal Nehru University in New Delhi. So his interests include interculturalism, of course, globalization, theater, secularism, the politics of faith, public culture, oral history, terror, and of course, performance and performative arts. Beside lecturing or working at the university, Rustam is known as a as an author of unique research studies, of which we can talk later on. And he has been described as an independent writer, dramaturg, director, cultural critic, theoretician of performative arts. In his work, he combines intercultural theory and practice with social concerns. He is also an author of several books on cultural exchange, globalization, secularism, oral history, and the question of questions of faith. So some of his most influential titles include Theater and the World, The Question of Faith in the Name of the Secular, and so on. And his latest book, The Terror and Performance, which is available here after you finish, after the lecture, you can purchase this book here at the exit. And his work also includes a strong activist component, I would say so, because he has conducted workshops with and for marginalized groups in India, the Philippines, Brazil, and the Republic of South Africa, where he has tried to redefine the relationship between culture and social development by working on subjects such as land and memory, the politics of touch, the migration, and the social transformation. What is more important here is he is here not so much to give a scriptured academic lecture, but rather to conduct a dialectic intervention and to share his view of his experience of interculturalism. He will also map it as the development of the category of interculturalism, and he will elaborate on his motifs for criticizing the term or the category. As a person from theater, as he likes to say, he will also show how interculturalism is used both in theater and in policy, and how the terms can differ, and how they could perhaps have a mutual. I'm missing a word now. Connection or exchange that could benefit the both sides. Yes, with practical examples, also that you will mention. He will show how they can work together to create new values, especially in dealing with marginalized groups, especially in the light of the recent or modern day contemporary migrant crisis. And finally, we will invite the audience to have a discussion and to discuss, of course, about all the topics that I've said, and also about the impact of developing or opening of the Intercultural Center here in Zagreb. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for being here. And thank you for that very warm, accurate introduction. He's really been spying on me. He's not just spying on me, he's spying on what I was planning to say. I just hope I measure up to what he said. So I'm very, very grateful for this invitation, Yanya, and the entire team. I find myself both excited and challenged. Excited because I don't think it's very often that one receives an invitation to address such a wide spectrum of activists, intellectuals, cultural workers, who are not just interested in reflecting on the concept of interculturalism, but who are actually committed in different ways to building an intercultural social center. And that kind of invitation doesn't come too often, you know, so I'm excited. So as a theater person, a dramaturg, my job basically is to translate thoughts and words into actions. And I think what we have here is a potential action. What we have here in this room is perhaps a process which has already begun with the conference, which is going to lead to the action of building an intercultural social center. So I think that's a very, very critically demanding kind of action. It's a tough one, but I think it's urgently needed in our times. Now, having said that, I also find myself obviously very challenged because I don't live in Croatia and I don't know enough about the complexities of your political and social and economic context. I know that your politics indeed, like many other politics, has been in transition. And so these are complexities that I would duly respect. And this, I have to make a qualification. I'm not here as any kind of advisor, or any kind of consultant. This would be absurd. I am here simply to share how this concept of interculturalism has impacted on my life for a very long time. And I should come out and say right at the outset, and I haven't said this before in any public meeting, but I feel the time is ripe. I am a diehard interculturalist. But, and I think that it's for me, it's not never been an academic subject alone, although I'm identified as an academic in the field. It is a life principle for me. But the problem is we don't quite know what interculturalism is today. That's the problem. So what are we committing ourselves to? Because this category is indeed very, very complex. I've been writing about interculturalism since 1977. That's a long time. And 1977, I left home for the first time, home being Calcutta, India, and I went to the United States to study. And within a month of being there in September 1977, I was actually encountering the word and engaging with the word as a student. And that search has continued. Now, I should qualify, I've written about interculturalism, yes, but I've written about it primarily within the framework of performance, practice, and theory. I have not written about interculturalism as policy to date. And if you had to read some of the early writings, which is not necessary at all, I think there are one or two sentences or suggestions I've made in my early writings that interculturalism is not a policy. Multiculturalism is a policy. But today, in today's political climate, I would have to radically rethink that position. And indeed, I am indeed, let me say, quite challenged about thinking of interculturalism as policy. Now, the irony is that in my field at this particular time of performance studies, the term interculturalism is passé. It's a dinosaur category. Nobody wants to touch it, you know? It's over and done with, okay? But at this particular juncture, I find it really interesting that politicians, policymakers, and activists across the board are turning to interculturalism in many different ways. So we are at a very interesting historical juncture, and I thank you for this invitation, because frankly, I would never have articulated what I'm articulating now, you know, if I hadn't received this invitation. Now, what's interesting for me and challenging for me is that, yes, I've never written about interculturalism as policy, but from the beginning, I do believe I had a political reading of interculturalism. And this got me marked in the field as a third world voice, a dissenting voice, the critic of Peter Brook, et cetera, et cetera. You know, I was sort of othered in that discourse. And life, we've moved on. It's all in the past in some ways. But now I'm excited because now that interculturalism is being seen politically, you know, across the spectrum, I'm beginning to wonder, can the politics that I read in interculturalism, can that actually be translated into policy? So the question I'm posing to myself is, to what extent can the political reading of interculturalism within the framework of performance theory and practice influence interculturalism as policy? That's the challenge I face. So, what was interculturalism? I said that I discovered it in the 1970s. It was a term that was circulating in performance study circles, primarily New York University, through the writings of Richard Schechner. It was never a political kind of concept. It was indeed rather apolitical. But at a very general level, interculturalism was positioned against internationalism. Now, we know that internationalism is a very loaded category, a big history. Nothing was ever dealt with there. No political theory whatsoever. Internationalism was a signifier for all those official, formal exchanges of cultures across the borders of nation states, mediated by cultural institutions. And these could include British Council, Alliance Française, and government bodies. So basically, it was this formal kind of exchange of culture. That's internationalism. This is how Schechner kind of formulated it. And against that, interculturalism was this free and open space. We continue to use these words, free, open, okay? A free and open space where all kinds of exchanges could take place, primarily between artists and theater companies. No social groups were ever mentioned in that period of interculturalism. We're not talking about social groups. We're talking about individual artists. We're talking about companies who, for any number of reasons, are interested in forging some kind of a relationship with, quote, non-Western cultures. Okay? Now, obviously, I was a bit provoked. Given the way this binary was kind of set up, I said, what's the reciprocity in this relationship? And in my reading at that time, and still is, that the non-West was some kind of a repository of materials, techniques, resources, which could be used, transported to Europe and America, wherever, and then reused in all kinds of creative ways for the creation of narratives and productions, which were ultimately seen in Europe and America. The non-West never got to see these productions. So what are we in relation to the product, you know? So that was the thrust of my kind of critique. And basically, I tried to formulate it, and I said that interculturalism was driven by what could be considered as voluntary and autonomous relationships. I think these words continue to resonate for us today. No one could be forced to be intercultural. Interculturalism is a choice. It's not a policy that somebody, you've got to be interculturalism, otherwise you're not a good citizen. No, no, no. And it is an avocation, the pursuit of specific desires for what Schechner called cultures of choice. Now, I had a real problem with this category of cultures of choice. And I found myself asking that this category basically assumes the availability of choices within the framework of privilege, the freedom to travel, and the access to cultural and social capital. And this is not a context that can be readily assumed in all parts of the world. And I think I also found myself saying, it's one thing for you to choose another culture. Have you ever cared to find out if that other culture wants to have anything to do with you? You know, maybe they're not interested, you know? So this was the kind of thinking that I had at that point in time. And later on, when I began to formulate it much later, I realized that we're really dealing with what could be called the political philosophy of liberal individualism. So liberal individualism is still very much around. I don't think there's anything wrong with it, but I think it needs to be kind of counterpointed with other social and communitarian concerns. Okay, that's all. So my critique of interculturalism, I guess, was directly linked to what has been called the politics of location. So from my location, you know, I realized the world is not an even and fair playing field. I realized it was not possible for me to be intercultural or to do an intercultural production. There was no money for it. There was no guarantee that I would ever even be able to travel. So way back in the 80s, I remember in a statement I made in Germany somewhere, I said, the theater of interculturalism begins with the trauma of obtaining a visa. Act one. Act two, encounter with immigration official. You got the visa, there's no guarantee that you're going to be able to cross the border. Let me tell you, as an Indian passport holder, that situation has become worse over the years. I may be a very, in a sense, privileged researcher traveling all over, but it is hell to travel. And I should also add that coming to Croatia is not simple. It's a very difficult procedure. I could give you elaborate details on this, okay? So the freedom to travel is something that you cannot just readily assume it's available. There's a wonderful play by Beckett called Happy Days, which I'm sure many of you know. And in Act One of Happy Days, there's this character called Winnie, and she's very jolly and cheerful, a middle-class woman, and she's incarcerated in mud up to her waist. In Act One, in Act Two, the mud is up to here. And she's just stuck in mud, she can't move. And at one point she says, ah, mobility, what a curse. And it's a wonderfully ironic line, but unfortunately today I would have to say that when you think of the condition of refugees and asylum seekers, indeed, that enforced mobility, that perpetual mobility, that mobility without a destination, is indeed some kind of a curse. And we're up against something very, very harsh. So with this politics of location driving my critique of interculturalism, I'll just gloss a few things that bothered me at that time. One was the use of universalisms, masquerading and disguising arrogant forms of Eurocentricity, and that still continues. I was bothered by the techniques of decontextualization, and by this I mean simply that when you're drawn to another culture, but only to certain aspects of the culture, you select those aspects, you wrest them out of their context, you take them somewhere else, and you create another context out of it. That's fine, you have to recontextualize, but then there's a certain kind of ethics that goes into taking things out of context, and I think that situation is certainly very relevant when we're dealing with interculturalism as policy. I was concerned, of course, with the exoticization of the other and the flip side of exoticization, which would be inferiorization of the other. And I was also troubled by issues relating to cultural tourism and the risks of what I would call self-exoticization. And this tends to occur when the natives, the foreigners, the outsiders are expected to perform for the host country. And that's when you bring out all your primordial cultural practices, okay? So these were some of the things that you can, this is all in the past, but I mean, this is the framework. I think it's only fair that I give you some actual examples of intercultural theater practice, because I do realize that maybe not everybody is familiar with the context. So very briefly, I'm going to just focus on three. So in the 1970s, when interculturalism was circulating, there was a very famous production that was doing the festival circuit. This is Peter Brook's The Ik. And this is a very, very smash hit production. Who are the Ik? The Ik are a small ethnic community of around 10,000 people living in northeast Uganda who were displaced from their land to create a national park. The Ik are the subject of a very famous but controversial anthropological study by Colin Turnbull called The Mountain People. It's quite a classic in anthropological studies. And Turnbull there gives us a very, very bleak picture of this community who have resorted to extreme individualistic practices by forcibly starving children and elderly people to death. So there's no resources, the land is not there, the food is not there, agriculture is not there. How do you survive? You survive by basically killing the weakest in your community, children and the elderly. Obviously a horrifying kind of situation, really brutal. And I don't want to valorize this study. It's been deeply critiqued. Turnbull, like, no, all anthropologists are not objective. And he basically lands up recommending that if you want these people not to kill each other, if you want that community to survive, well, separate them. Keep them apart, which is a very, very harsh kind of solution, if it is a solution at all. So anyway, this was the subject matter of Brooks' production, a very, very chic kind of production where the Ik simply babbled in non-verbal idiom. Can you believe that? And today that would never pass. That kind of, I might say that we've moved on. That would never, never pass today, getting the natives to babble and the anthropologists speaking French. So, but more critically, in the program note of the first production, and this is pointed out by Kenneth Tynan, a famous drama critic at that time, he said, quote, "As far as anyone knows, the Ik still exist." That was said in the program note, which means that they're doing a play about people who are in this wretched condition, but they haven't really cared to find out what their condition is. I think enough said. Another kind of production I'll just throw out, this is more recent. It's a 6-hour epic production by Théâtre du Soleil, Ariane Nushkin, another great director, called Le Dernier Caravanserai, which is a kind of epic encapsulation of refugees, asylum seekers, boat people from all possible communities. You have Kurds, Chechens, Iranians, Russians. They're all kind of put into the same kind of homogenized state of destitution. They're always on the move. The mise-en-scène was all about movement. Nobody was ever stuck, very powerful visual. But I think what I would simply say, this kind of mise-en-scène about refugees and asylum seekers, which many of you are really dealing with directly, it becomes a kind of what I call spectacularization of suffering. And this kind of spectacularization of suffering with big effects is all too easily consumed. And indeed, we know that when John Howard, the erstwhile Prime Minister of Australia, saw this production, it seems that he was moved to tears. And he said, this is what it's all about. And this was the very man who, as the Prime Minister of Australia, had the audacity to say, we will decide who comes to this country. They don't decide. So you can imagine how productions, in a sense, feed, you know, certain kinds of political agendas. But let's keep in mind that the spectacularization of suffering is something that we're all part of through our complicity in watching television and the reportage that we see of both people who are in these harrowing kinds of circumstances. And what do? We consume it for the most part. Okay, let's keep in mind that it's not just artists who represent refugees and asylum seekers. Refugees and asylum seekers in the most extreme conditions, I'm talking about detention centers in Australia, and I've referred to this in my book, Terror and Performance. I hope some of you will read it. It's very, very harsh evidence, but also important for us to keep in mind that many of these asylum seekers have resorted to their own modes of activism, a kind of activist performance, and they have done this by resorting to very extreme practices like lip sewing and blood graffiti. So actually sewing their lips and cutting their veins, taking their own blood and painting slogans on the walls of prisons like freedom, slogans that probably no one will ever read, but they're doing it. Why are they doing it? Because they have no other language. They have no other legal recourse. So they're falling back on their own bodies because that's the only thing that they can be said to own to make these statements. And there's something very, very heart-wrenching and humbling about these performances. There have been other more elaborate attempts recently to incorporate real refugees and real asylum seekers into the mise-en-scène of very big productions. There was a production, the text was by Elfriede Jelinek, a great radical writer, as we know. It's called The Wards in English. And it basically deals with the contemporary situation of asylum seekers, hundreds of Somali and Eritrean refugees drowned off the coast of Lampedusa. And it's intersected with motifs from Aeschylus's The Suppliants. This is, I think, quite a brilliant dramaturgy to turn to Aeschylus, one of the great tragedians, you know, from classical Athens, the Greek drama. And she's intersecting the Greek drama with this contemporary situation. I think very powerful. I saw this production at the opening night of the Theater der Welt in Mannheim. Yes, it was powerful. It was, yes, but I think more visually powerful than it was discursive. And yes, it was heartwarming to see real actors and real refugees hold hands and take the curtain call, you know, towards the end of the performance. That's the ritual we have in Europe. Any number of curtain calls, audience giving a standing ovation, everybody feeling extraordinarily, you know, what can I say, moved by the democratic potentiality of theater, etc. Unfortunately, democracy in theater is very short-lived. So what happens is that after all that, you know, you go out of the theater into the lobby, and there you have a post-production discussion with all the serious critics, but there are no refugees or asylum seekers on that forum. They're on the, in the lobby, on the periphery, sort of disappearing into the walls, and this is what I think Giorgio Agamben would call the state of inclusive exclusion. And that's what we're dealing with all the time. Okay. Enough said about intercultural practice. In 1987, I returned to India, and I returned with an intercultural theater project. I won't get into it, but let's say that that intercultural theater project involved the adaptation of a play by Franz Xaver Krutz called Request Concert in different Asian cities. So the idea was to redo the play in the context of different Asian cities. So in India, I was doing the play in Calcutta, in Bombay, in Madras, with three very different actresses in three very different scenarios. And to cut the long story short, I discovered that the word intercultural was no longer working for me. I'm talking at a theatrical level. It was not working for me. I was no longer dealing with the exchanges of cultures across nation states. I was dealing with something else. I was dealing with regional kinds of differences. So if interculturalism, to put it far too simply, is the exchange of negotiation of cultural differences across and between nation states, the intracultural is concerned with the negotiation and exchange of cultures within the framework of the nation state, within the framework of specific regions, within the framework of specific communities, within the framework of specific events. So, for example, if I wanted to open up the interculturality of this event right now, yes, there are people who've come from other countries, etc. If I had to open up what is Croatian, all the Croatian representatives over here, within that sort of homogenized category of Croatian, there would be any number of differences. Differences relating to region, difference to religious affiliation, gender, and so on and so forth, okay? Today, that concept of intercultural has become a very, very important political concept for me. And I'm no longer thinking of it in relation to theater practice. I'm relating it primarily to conflict, to the most serious eruptions of conflict that we have all suffered, whether it's in the former Yugoslavia or in India. And I would say it's very hard to understand, why do people kill each other? Why do people who've been neighbors, who've lived together, why do they kill each other? Impossible. How can you ever answer that question? But perhaps you could say that maybe we have to learn how to confront maybe what I call the submerged ethnicities, apparently reconciled within the framework of secularism. Submerged ethnicities, apparently reconciled. So you feel, yeah, we're living together. Yeah, fine, cool, you know? But there is something else going on here that we haven't quite put our finger on. And that's where the intercultural lies. It refers to the differences that do not appear to be different at all. Beware of them. I'd like to focus on the partition of India, huge event. India, independent India, was founded on a bloodbath, the partition, where millions of people were killed, butchered, on either side of the border, in the most bestial, insane way possible. In trying to understand such events, I'm not a political theorist, I'm not a philosopher, I'm just, I guess, a theater worker at the end of the day. I have to understand these conflicts at ground level. So I try to understand these conflicts at ground levels through very minute sort of cultural negotiations. I have found oral history to be a very valuable source of illumination in this regard. Oral history is something we need to take really respect far more seriously. And even when I get all kinds of literature on interculturalism and intercultural policy and so on, my eye always goes to those quotations of the people who are actually going through that process, where they talk about what they ate or what they didn't eat, their fooding, their clothing, how they went from this point to that point. For me, that evidence really makes me think very powerfully. So there's this very strong book called The Other Side of Silence by Urvashi Buttalia on the partition. And in that book, there's a sequence where an elderly Sikh gentleman from the Sikh community is remembering the painful past, and he's saying, you know, we Sikhs and Muslims, we all live together like one family. How often have we heard that refrain? We live together like one family. When they had festivals, we would go to their homes. When we had festivals, they would come to our homes. Of course, they're Muslim. Mm-hmm. So we tell them, please sit in that corner and eat. And after you finish eating, please clean the utensils. Next sentence. And that is why partition happened. It's an extraordinary slippage for me. Now, this is the kind of thing no academic can do. Academics can't work with slippages. Our job is to work through the contradiction as far as possible. This would not be acceptable. But an ordinary man talking about the past, he's a direct victim of that past and survivor. He makes the slippage, and he goes from something very, 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 very small to something very big. And he's saying something really important, because what he's really calling attention to are the submerged dimensions of caste which underlie normalcy. All the stigmatization of caste that we live with that has been normalized, well, it's there, it's festering. And if you don't really address it, there's going to be trouble. I don't have a theory of violence, but I would simply say and request all of us here to be very mindful of the little differences, because the little differences that don't appear to be different at all can be virulent. I'll give you just one brief example of intracultural theater. This took place in India. I was involved in an interaction with a community called the Siddhi. The Siddhi are persons of African origin who have come to India over centuries as soldiers, as sailors, as mercenaries, and as slaves. And they are the unacknowledged blacks of India. There are only about 40,000 Siddhi living in India, and since we are 1.3 billion people, 40,000 really amounts to a very small minority. They're scattered in different parts of the country, in Gujarat, in Karnataka, in Andhra Pradesh, in Goa, etc. And let's say that I was part of a project where the idealism was, let's bring the Siddhi together, because the state has not done anything in this regard. So let us, as activists, cultural workers, find a way of bringing the Siddhi together from different parts of the country. It's quite an interesting ideal. What did we achieve? When we brought them together, what really came out were the intracultural differences. So what united them was one thing, the color of their skin. But we know that color of the skin is one thing, but what about other things? So they're divided, we found, at every level, economically. So that we had Siddhis who were wretchedly poor agricultural laborers. You had Siddhis in other parts of India who were aspiring towards a kind of upward mobility, middle-class mobility. They were divided by language. There was no language they shared. They spoke Marathi, they spoke Telugu, they spoke Gujarati, etc. No language in common. And they were divided by religion, because they're Hindu Siddhi, they're Muslim Siddhi, and they're Christian Siddhi, and they come with their own kinds of, you know, support systems. So at the end of the day, in this harrowingly difficult workshop, I really had to say, what are we doing, you know? And this is something I feel that in activism, many people would probably share similar stories. We're driven by certain kinds of ideals, which are great, and we want to work towards solidarity of the oppressed, but we don't always know that perhaps within that category of the oppressed, which is itself a homogenized category, there are any number of differences. And we have to be prepared to take them on. Okay. So I've talked to you a little bit about interculturalism, intraculturalism, which is the term that I really would like to invest more in. So what about multiculturalism? That hoary category, that really overstated category, problematic category in some ways. I've never been turned on by multiculturalism, I should tell you bluntly. I've never had any real desire for multiculturalism. I, as an academic, I duly acknowledge it, but it really doesn't really excite me, I should say. And without any cynicism, I should probably say that multiculturalism as a word would never have existed in the English language had it not been for the realities of immigration. So for example, in the mid-50s in countries like Britain, when immigrants were indeed welcome, so they weren't illegal, they were welcome. Why were they welcome? Well, if I may put it candidly, to do the dirty work and to support the economy and the labor. They were the cheap labor force of those countries. Everything's fine. When these immigrants then claim their rights of citizenship, after all, they are democratic societies, that's when the problems really begin. Because when that person from that other country becomes a citizen, there's this nominal notion that you share certain things on the basis of equality, but they don't think like us, they don't feel like us, they don't talk like us, etc., etc. Multiculturalism, I think, gets invented to manage these differences. And that word came up today in our discussion today. Management is still very much with us. I don't like that word, but we have to live with it. It's a management policy in some ways, where the state calls the shots. And that was always my problem with the term. Of course, there were certain parts of Europe, like Germany, where this problem didn't exist. Why? Because the Gastarbeiter, the guest worker, could not be, in a sense, a citizen. That was the condition. You come here, you do your work, you go back. Easier said than done. So generation after generation, after three generations of Gastarbeiters, you know. And still, only now is the possibility of citizenship open to, let's say, the Turkish workers. Only now. Do you think that integration can really work with memories of that history? Do you think it's going to be that simple? Can people just forget the fact that for 50 years they were guest workers and not entitled, you know, to basic rights? Well, it's going to be a hard struggle. So what about India? One could say India is massively multicultural. You wouldn't know where to begin or end to count the so-called diversities, very tangible diversities. Just to give you a few facts, 23 national languages, official national languages, 8 scripts, so you can't even read the newspaper from the next state, you know. At least 6 major religions, these are the facts, okay? Every single region of India at a performative level, and it sounds like you're bragging, but, you know, it's not bragging, it's just sort of, well, these are the facts and they're problematic. So each region of India to this day, and I was talking earlier to you and your friend, maybe because the state has no cultural policy. Keep that in mind. India, forget intercultural, multicultural. There's no cultural policy in the country. And you sometimes wonder, do you think some friends despair about that? Oh, we need a cultural policy. I said, yeah, but how would they use it, you know? The state has not really, in a sense, cared to deal with these cultures. So we have any number of diversities in this country. In every region, multiple epic traditions, oral narrative traditions, classical dance traditions, folk theater traditions, ritual performance traditions, shamanic performances, spirit possession, you name it. It's all there. Now, at one level, you say, how rich? Yeah, sure, it's rich. It's an embarrassment of riches. And if you're being, you know, positive, you could say it leads to self-sufficiency because you've got so much. But does it lead to interactivity? No. You see, if you're so self-sufficient, within you've got everything, you've got epics, you've got folk, you've got this, why the hell would you be interested in knowing what the people across the border are interested in? This is the problem. So diversities do not necessarily produce interactivity. This is something I'd like to push a little further. Diversity has become a feel-good category. And of course, everybody, I of course have to support diversities. Diversities make our world a lot more colorful, more varied. The potentiality for dialogue, etc., is great. But let's be a little careful and not so euphoric about terms. I would say just as diversities do not necessarily lend themselves to interactivity, diversity should not be conflated with pluralism. They are two totally different words and two totally different categories. Unfortunately, some of the biggest thinkers I've known, that slippage is always there. Because you're diverse, we're pluralists. We live in a pluralist society. Sorry. Diversities do not necessarily produce plurality. Diversities are givens. Diversities are what you inherit, maybe through your birth, maybe through your socialization. But pluralism is a political principle that demands the negotiation of differences through different forms of arbitration, either by the state or by civil society or by community bodies, okay? And that's a totally different ballgame. So I think what we have to put on the agenda is that diversities actually cannot be separated from differences and social disparities. And in fact, you cannot, in a sense, separate them. Unfortunately, that's what we tend to do. So if you see an indigenous performance tradition, you say, wow, what great diversity is on site here. You see the distinctive cultural expression of this indigenous group of people. Look at the energy, look at the costumes, look at the feathers, look at, et cetera, the drumming, et cetera. But once they take off that, you know, the feathers and the paint, what are they? Non-citizens, marginalized by poverty, social stigmatization of caste, and other forms of exclusion. So you want to see the performance of diversity, but you don't want to necessarily deal with the harsh realities that go with it. I think that's the problem. Let us now move more towards multicultural policy. Let's be quite candid about this. Multiculturalism as policy exists in many different parts of the world. I am personally familiar somewhat with Australia, Canada, and Britain. It exists in Sweden. It exists in many, many other parts of the world. And it means different things in different parts of the world, okay? When we use this umbrella category, multicultural, it doesn't mean that automatically all countries will be following it in the same way. Point two, multiculturalism has a history. So in each of these countries, there are certain phases of multiculturalism. So if you talk about multiculturalism in Britain, there are at least three phases of multiculturalism. I'm not an expert in this area or anything, but basically the movement is from assimilation into integration. That's become the catchword. But it's a very complicated kind of process. Today, there's a really hot, heated, anguished debate going on among multicultural scholars or scholars of multiculturalism. And they're kind of anguished because politicians like Angela Merkel, David Cameron, Sarkozy, and others, in some stray remarks, Peeting, have said words to the effect that multiculturalism has failed. It's time we come up with a new policy. Interculturalism enters. It's not that simple. And these very serious scholars, really top scholars who've done a lot of work on multiculturalism, are provoked. I'm talking of scholars like Charles Taylor, Will Kimlicker, and more recently, Tariq Modood and Nasser Mir, who've written a very, very influential article basically defending multiculturalism. And it's received a lot of support from a whole lot of, you know, scholars in this field. So I'm going to kind of, you know, just summarize it a little bit. According to these critics, multiculturalism is being caricatured and criticized, not just for wrong reasons, but for precisely the very reasons multiculturalism has advocated, I would add, at least in theory. Therefore, far from being sectarian and closed, this is the charge, these critics would say multiculturalism has always recommended dialogue and interactivity. This is supposed to be the intercultural, the mantras, okay? And they're saying, sorry, when Charles Taylor was writing about the politics of recognition, recognition is not possible without dialogue. Okay, so theoretical arguments. These critics would say that, you know, the charge is, oh, multiculturalism just plays into illiberal values. And interculturalism is liberal. I'm trying to make it, you know, kind of schematic. And they're saying, no, this is not true. Multiculturalism has encouraged difficult debates around religious issues relating to blasphemy. Think of the Salman Rushdie affair in Britain. And the right to assert religious symbols in a secular public space. And they've also argued that multiculturalism has never played into ghettoization, which is the primary charge that has been brought against multiculturalism. So many people, when they want to knock multiculturalism, they just say, oh, it just leads into ghettos. Well, there are some very important theorists and thinkers who believe that. And I'm going to quote Zizek from very much your part of the world. And this is what Zizek had to say. It's a little theoretical, but I'll read it now. He says, multiculturalism is a disavowed, inverted, self-referential form of racism. It's a racism with a distance. It respects the other's identity, conceiving the other as a self-enclosed, authentic community, towards which he, the multiculturalist, maintains a distance rendered possible by his privileged universal position. The multiculturalist respect for the other's specificity is the very form of asserting one's own superiority. It's a very strong statement. It's a kind of imperialism actually at work. So you put these people into the boxes, they preserve their authenticity, and by preserving their authenticity, in a sense, you ride above them and you claim this universal position. Well, this is how theory works. It's not just activists who have struggles and they have, believe me, theorists have their own struggles as well. And I have to say I'm somewhat persuaded by Žižek's statement, but at an empirical level, and Žižek is no empiricist, let me tell you, it could be argued that multiculturalism, I'm going to see another point of view, multiculturalism has worked in bringing together individuals from diverse communities sharing the same public space. And I'm thinking here specifically of London, you know. And in London, when you're traveling in the tube, for God's sake, you see people from every different part of the world. They're sharing the same space. You go to Waterloo, you know, the station, in that public space, there are people everywhere. And for me as a theater person, it's not just people sharing a space, it's how do they share the space? See, in the 70s, when I was as an Indian going to London, yes, I was in that space, but I could see people from my part of the world kind of, you know, disappearing, not wanting to be visible. This is no longer the case in London. You can be from wherever you want to be, and you assert yourself in the way you walk. You claim your space. You speak your accented English in whatever way, you know, no big deal. So, and let's think of the mayor of London. Who is he? He's a Muslim, right? But I would say he's a Londoner. And that man could never have been the mayor had it not been for multiculturalism. No way. He's a product of multiculturalism. And he's a damn good mayor. He certainly knows how to deal with the likes of Donald Trump. You know, he's got his politics very clearly marked in a nice way. But let's complicate this. So this kind of multicultural sociality, let's call it, is very evident in London. But would you find it in Bradford? Would you find it in Nottingham? Would you find it in Oldham? No, you wouldn't. And so when you move into those other kinds of smaller towns, there again, once again, you see the ethnicities continuing to be bound and segregated, seething with communal tensions. So this compels one to ask whether the benefits of multiculturalism, as affirmed by scholars like Modood and Mir, are more likely to be found in the metropolis rather than in suburban and rural areas. And I want to shift here to a little bit to thinking about the subject in relation to intercultural policy. This came up today in today's discussion. How does one find a way of disseminating intercultural policy so that it does not seem to privilege the city over small towns and villages? So that doesn't just play into the cosmopolitan privileges that you as people living in Zagreb might have, going to the museum, going to the theater, going to the film festival, Yebo. But what about people living elsewhere? You know, how does it reach them? And if you don't reach them, what do you think are the consequences? How can interculturalism, I would ask, be more actively democratized through a new distribution of the sensible? Distribution of the sensible is, of course, a construction by Jacques Rossière. It's a hugely important concept. He's not talking about the production of the sensible. He's not talking about the reception of the sensible. He's saying, how can it be distributed so that it is no longer the property of one group of people, but it can actually filter into all parts of the country? Okay, I realize this is a bit long, but I'll try and make it short. I want to cut to the year 2008 when I really began to work on intercultural policy. And this was my only real, you know, hands-on experience with it. 2008 is a really important year because this was the year when the European Council passed a white paper on interculturalism and UNESCO published its World Report on Cultural Diversity, both of which tacitly acknowledged that multiculturalism had failed, okay? And it was in 2008 that I was invited by a cultural organization in Dublin, Ireland, CREATE, to participate in a year-long consultancy along with many other people on the framing of, what would they call it? A report on cultural diversity in the arts. Okay, so this was my hands-on experience. I won't go into the details. I'll just mention three problems I faced. One would simply be the epistemological confusion around the terms interculturalism and multiculturalism. And I haven't been able to resolve it. And I would have to ask all of you here, very seriously, it's your problem too. When you claim that you want to build an intercultural social center, what do you mean by intercultural? Okay? Do you have a history of the multicultural against which you posit the intercultural? Why couldn't you just say Zagreb, you know, social center or whatever? What is it about the intercultural that really you feel is so important? And this is a real problem. There are no easy answers here. Now, what happened in Ireland? I kept getting all these bulletins and material. There's no dearth of material in all of this, you know. For cultural policy, it's just accumulation of papers. So you'll get multicultural policy for the police force, multicultural policy on health, multicultural policy for community arts, multicultural policy for health, or whatever. And it's just too much. And you're reading about social inclusion, respect, dialogue, diversity, tolerance, ad infinitum, ad nauseum. But when you're reading all this, I said, but this thing intercultural, for me, this is multicultural. There's no difference. The language is exactly what multiculturalism is doing. It's state-determined, it's very patronizing, it's about how much the state really cares, you know, for its minorities and its new immigrants, et cetera, et cetera. So they're saying interculturalism, but to me, it is sounding exactly like multicultural. And very interestingly, in Ireland, there is no multicultural policy, you know? So the two terms indeed get conflated, and this is a problem we have to deal with. How do you want to define these words? Two, the problem of scale was brought up today by our colleague from Sweden in a very, very interesting way. I think scale is a hugely complex issue in dealing with policy or indeed dealing with any kind of practice. Now, what I found very difficult as a writer was there was a complete disjunction, you know, a schism between the realities on the ground and the demands that were being made rhetorically by policymakers. So policy demands objectivity, statistical data, a kind of a macro kind of position. But like, let's say, what is the position of Africa in diversity in the arts? Now, what is Africa, for God's sake? That's a continent. Are you dealing with Nigerians? Are you dealing with people from Cameroon? And how many Africans are you really dealing with? I actually talked to five, okay? Now, I believe that if you're a sensitive policymaker, the opinion of those five individuals matters, definitely. But how do you actually factor it into the rhetoric of policymaking? This is very difficult. Time and again, across migrant and minority communities, one encountered the same frustration that they were being made to tick off boxes to get state funding, trying to answer impossible questions like, do you have a diversity policy? For how long has it been enforced? Is it sustainable, etc.? What can these questions possibly mean to artists from minority and migrant communities struggling to survive, barely finding time over the weekends for so-called artistic activities, conducted in makeshift rehearsal spaces with almost no budget whatsoever? That's the ground reality. They're struggling. They can barely hold a rehearsal together, you know? And you're asking them to account for their diversity? What is this? The most acute problem that I faced during the CREATE consultancy brings us back to the problem of the inner differences animating intra-culturalism, which I brought up earlier in the talk. Among the diverse migrant and ethnic communities whom I met during my consultancy, the most socially stigmatized was the traveler community, which was emphatically not marked as migrant or ethnic by the Irish government, unlike in Northern Ireland, where the traveler community is marked as ethnic. Here one faces a violent contradiction, and indeed, it's something that you might have to face. Even as a traveler community is officially designated as white, Catholic, English-speaking, and Irish, it is socially ostracized and demeaned for its peripatetic lifestyle and resistance to the norms of social propriety. Very similar to the Roma. It's a very similar kind of condition. Its inner differences within Irish mainstream society, marking out its intraculturality as opposed to its possibilities of interculturality, have all the signs of the virulence of caste. I never thought that when I left India that I would be encountering caste. But the more I travel, I realize that caste exists in many, many different forms. And certainly what one encountered with the traveler community was the stigma of untouchability. Shocking. Their condition compels one to ask a critical question. How does one position the internalized others of any European society within the framework of intercultural policy? And with this question in mind, I'm going to raise a bigger problem. Even as the policy of interculturalism today across Europe seems to be driven primarily by the needs of refugees and asylum seekers, whose otherness is explicitly marked, what are the implications of restricting this policy to them alone? It seems to me that we run the risk of reinventing the wheel by placing the target groups of refugees and asylum seekers at the center of interculturalism and as the primary beneficiaries of the policy, not unlike the way in which first-generation immigrants in the 1950s in countries like Britain and their subsequent struggle for citizenship fueled the policy of multiculturalism. In both scenarios, the risk is for the so-called natives of the host country to absent themselves from the larger imperatives of realizing intercultural agendas. I believe it is a mistake to imagine that any form of interculturalism can succeed if the citizens of the host country do not see themselves as active participants and potential beneficiaries in the process of interculturality. In this regard, it is not enough to assume that refugees and asylum seekers will have to learn how to settle into Europe. Those who assume a belonging to Europe also have a responsibility in rethinking and renegotiating their assumptions in relation to the rights of citizenship. And this is the hardest reality to face. But we need to keep in mind that the inter, however you wish to define it, demands recognition of the in-between, where parties on both sides are equally responsible for creating a new dynamics in the process of social interaction. We're all involved in this, okay? Not just them, although we're making a policy for them. We too have a responsibility. So I'll finally, on a more practical note, just let me point out the illusions of dialogue that exist in the current investigations of interculturalism. This is one of the most reiterated categories. We're always supposed to be in dialogue, but actually no one is in dialogue. So academics are not in dialogue with policymakers. Academics from social sciences are not in dialogue with academics from performance theory. I might add that whatever I've been talking about, you know, with Schechner and all that 1970s, we don't exist in the bibliography of Modood and Mir. We don't exist. You know, there's no dialogue. Okay, there's no dialogue certainly between politicians and refugees, hardly a dialogue, you know. And sometimes, of course, there have been very interesting examples. This is in Quebec, and I think Quebec is really something to study. In 2007, the Quebec government approached Charles Taylor, top philosopher and sociologist Bouchard, to conduct what they called a consultation commission on accommodation practices related to cultural differences. And for a year, these two scholars held, you know, these forums with all kinds of citizens across the spectrum, and they produced a report at the end of the day. I think it's a fantastic initiative to bring scholars directly into contact with the public. But I'm afraid that whatever I've heard of this consultation, it wasn't particularly successful. And maybe the problem was that the language of the consultation remained far too academic. And the overall result, when you read the report, is one of a learned discourse on what is called reasonable accommodation. Now, nobody can be turned on by that. Reasonable accommodation. That's a social science, you know, academic good category, maybe. It doesn't really have any resonance, you know, for people at large, you know. So on the one hand, you have a problem with this sort of academicism, but there's another problem, and I wish to raise it, and that's the problem of dumbing down. And this is really becoming quite rampant in a lot of the messages where you don't seem to give any credit to the intelligence of people. So you dumb down the messages and basically cater to what is rampant all over the world, and that is cultural populism. And the populism should not be equated with the popular, for which, of course, I have a deep regard. So to create a new language for the actual rethinking of interculturalism within specific national contexts, it is absolutely vital that the dialogue needs to be enlivened through creativity. And here it becomes necessary to look beyond coteries of pundits or constituencies of activists as the ultimate arbiters of religious and cultural differences. Instead, I would make a strong pitch for the participation of artists, not just from the theater, but from the worlds of music, painting, sculpture, dance, installation art, and perhaps new forms of political commentary like stand-up comedy and blogging. I see these artists playing the role of intermediaries, adapting their skills to communicate the technicalities of policy making, making the agendas clear, but also questioning their assumptions in a dialogic manner. In this way, I do believe that there's a better chance of interculturalism being embraced by people at large instead of being imposed as a top-down policy, ostensibly being made for the good of people, but with no real heart or sense of the real. Thank you.